Croeso, diff da, bernachtin, gia chwich, fulcha, daemat. Welcome, welcome to the Celtic Myths and Legends podcast. I am your humble host, Sian Esther Powell, and I'm going to be taking you on a journey through all the myths and legends of the six Celtic nations. That's Wales, Cornwall, Brittany, Isle of Man, Scotland, and Ireland. Welcome, welcome. Hello, my friends. Welcome back to a new episode of the Celtic Myths and Legends podcast. I am, of course, your host, Sian Esther Powell, and I am currently in a blanket fort. Now, riddle me this. Why have I never done this before? I've got a blanket, like, covering my laptop and my microphone and everything. Why have I never done this before? This is surely podcast 101. That's, like, one of the main first tips they give you is put a blanket over everything so it muffles the sound and you're not having, you know, the sound echoing off hard surfaces. I don't know why I've never done this before. It is actually extremely fun and I feel very cozy right now. We are, of course, back to Scotland. So anyone who has been listening to this podcast for a while, and I repeat this every episode, and I'm going to keep repeating it, so yeah, whatever. Anyone who's been listening to me for a little while now will know that each episode I take in turns to focus on one of the six Celtic nations. And we are, of course, back on to Scotland, and I'm really, really excited about that, because we are finally, and don't ask me why it has taken me this long, but we are finally going to talk about one of my favourite folkloric creatures, which is, of course, drumroll, the Selkie. I think that it might have taken me so long to finally make an episode on the Selkie, because when I first started the podcast, there was a lot of podcast episodes on Selkies, right? And I was trying to talk about things that hadn't been covered as much. But the more that I have progressed with this podcast, and you'll know I'm not very prolific with it, so you might have a little chuckle at that, but the more I've progressed with it, and as the years gone by, and I've listened to other podcasts talking about mythology and folklore and storytelling and that kind of thing, I've realised that it doesn't matter if we cover the same subjects. There's so many beautiful, wonderful folklore and mythology podcasts out there, and I'm good sort of internet friends with a lot of people that make folklore podcasts, and I think they seem like lovely, brilliant people, and I love their shows. And you know what? There's room for all of us, because every single person will tell a story in a different way. We will each have our own delivery. We will have elements of the story that appeal to us much more. We'll emphasize certain aspects. We'll maybe embellish certain things. We'll take away certain things. Every single person will have a totally different spin on a story. And I actually think that's something to be celebrated. It's something beautiful and wonderful. And so I'm going to stop shying away from like really, really, really popular bits of folklore now. And I'm just going to do whatever I want, because as I said, everyone will have their own spin on folklore. So if I want to talk about Selkies, I'm going to talk about Selkies because I love them. So I guess it would be really helpful right now if I actually tell you what a Selkie is. Just like the basics, just so you're not like, what is she going on about? So, a Selkie is a seal maiden. It's almost like a mermaid type creature, except a seal instead of a fish, essentially. Now, the kind of common rules with Selkie folklore is that in the ocean, they're a complete seal. There's none like weird arms, human, you know, torso or anything like that. They're a total seal. Total seal. That almost sounds like a Hollywood action film. Give me the big bucks now, Hollywood. I've just watched Speed for the first time, so that's maybe why I'm really hyper. I really enjoyed it, to be honest. It was a pretty good action film. Anyway, tangent aside, Selkies are totally seals in the ocean, right? But when they step out of the ocean and onto land, they take off their seal skin and they are human underneath. So they can be a human maiden, a human woman. But that seal skin doesn't magically disappear. In fact, that seal skin is something incredibly, incredibly precious to the Selkie. It is their whole being and identity, that which links them back to their true home, the sea. So although they are a creature that can exist and can survive on land as well as in the sea is their true home. And that seal skin is the one thing that connects them to it. So it is totally precious. Now, one of the common elements of the Selkie folklore myths are that they need to look after that seal skin. They need to bury it and hide it somewhere where no one is going to find it. And it's not like they can just walk around with it on their person, right? Because people will know that they're a Selkie. People will know that they're a maiden of the sea, and that's not very good either. And it's going to be a lot easier for people to directly attack them and directly steal that seal skin from them if it is on their person. So the best idea really is for them to hide it, to bury it somewhere where no one is going to find it. But of course, stories have to include drama and betrayal and, you know, melancholy and all those wonderful, lovely things. So in lots of the stories, the seal skin is found, because you wouldn't have a story without it, would you? Oh, Selkie leaves ocean, buries seal skin, comes back to it next Tuesday, goes back into the ocean. That's not a fun story, is it, really? So all of these stories involve a Selkie's skin, their true identity being stolen. Now, this is fascinating to me because it's sort of rife for talking about women's place in society, because almost all of the stories concerning Selkies concern a female Selkie having her skin stolen by a human man and then being forced to be his wife. Now, this is very, very similar and a parallel to the swan maiden archetype of folklore. This is another form of folklore where a swan maiden, so very similar to a Selkie, sheds her swan skin, and then that skin is stolen by a human man who then forces the swan maiden to be his wife. And as well as Scottish mythology, you can also find Selkie myths in Faroese mythology and Scandinavian mythology as well. So there are a lot of fascinating things that you can say about women, and that is, again, one of my favourite things about folklore. Let's turn off my phone so you're not getting the sound of my bloody notifications. One of my favourite things about folklore is the fact that you can use it to have really interesting, complex, and sometimes quite difficult discussions on the past, but also contemporary society and life. So you can use the Selkie myth to make a point, or to explore maybe the idea of marriage, where one person holds a bit more power over another person. I think the Selkie myth is kind of perfect for exploring that idea. And those of you who will remember my Banshee episode and who have followed me on TikTok and other areas on the internet might remember my depressed Welsh Banshee character. Well, one day I'd love to write a sort of sitcom, sketch show, silly comedy thing with lots of different characters from Celtic mythology, and one of them is a Selkie who is either in marriage counselling or who is a marriage counsellor. I haven't decided yet, but I think that that could be pretty fun. What do you reckon? Don't steal my ideas. But you know what, even if you do, I'll just enjoy it. My brain is not very good, so I never have energy to do anything, which is why it takes me so long to do my podcast episodes, even though it's one of my favourite things in the world, and I wish that I just did them all of the time, and I wish that I just lived my life breathing and living folklore. But anyway, I digress. Oh, also, some of you might have seen my viral video I work in a museum, Will Martin Museum. It's a china clay mining museum. And recently I posted a video onto our newly created TikTok account and it's gone totally crazy, guys. It's got like 2 million likes and 10.5 million views. So it's been crazy. So I am sure that at least some of you listening will have come across that video. So yes, that is some of what I'm doing with my time. But anyway, I love folklore and I love this podcast. But I don't know if I've got the energy or the brains to write a whole sitcom comedy right now. So if someone else does, I guess I'll just enjoy it for what it is. But also don't do it, because I will do it eventually. And if you steal it, I will come and tell you off. So let's look at a typical Selkie myth and break it down a little bit, shall we? The majority of Selkie folklore seems to come from Shetland and Orkney. The typical structure of a Selkie folktale is usually a seal maiden finding herself on the beach with a human man who steals her seal skin and compels her to be his wife. Not the best start for a long-lasting happy marriage. A lot of dodginess in there. So even if things seem happy on the outside, a lot of these stories include children. You know, these marriages result in children. And I don't think that all of the Selkie maidens know that this man has done this. I think in some of the stories it's known that he's stolen the skin and he's compelled her to be his wife. In some of the tales, I think that it comes as a shock when they finally find their seal skin, like, how can he have done this to me? Quite easily, to be honest with you, which is more than a little bit horrifying, actually. There's some variations in the Selkie folk tales, but one thing remains pretty consistent throughout, and that is immediately after finding her seal skin, whether she's found it or her children have found it, and that's often the case in some stories, is the children find the seal skin and discover who their mother really truly is. In all of these stories, immediately after the seal skin has been found, she returns back to the ocean, having spent a whole marriage just longing for the sea, and in some of the marriages being really kind of imprisoned in this union that she doesn't even want to be in, but she's been compelled to be in because he has this power and this horrible dynamic over her, and she is the one with the less power and is dependent on him, knowing that he is in possession of her seal skin. So as I was saying before, I think you can make some really disturbing, unsettling kind of, you can use folklore to talk about disturbing and unsettling things that happen in real life as well, but you can do it in a way that's more palatable to people and sometimes easier to understand, because you don't have all of that defensiveness if it's a situation that you can readily recognize. I doubt many people are really kind of vibing with the whole, oh, I'm just going to peel off my seal skin right now. But we can probably relate to this idea of relationships with a kind of horrible dynamic and an imbalance of power. So that's one type of thing that you can draw from the Selkie myth. But another is, of course, the act of transformation, in the same way as, you know, werewolves and other stuff. But Selkies really have that lovely, beautiful element of transformation within the folktale. So that's probably another way that you can talk about contemporary issues by using folklore. Idea of transformation, changing from one state to another. And that is what happens. As soon as the Selkie finds her seal skin, she returns to the ocean, transforms back into her seal form and goes straight back into the ocean. In some stories, the children, the husband, never see her ever, ever, ever again. In some stories, she returns back to land, you know, once a year to be like, hi kids, how are you doing? Just here to pay my child support. Here's some shells. I don't know how it works. I'm not a Selkie. I'm not descended from Selkies. And apparently that's a thing. Some families can trace their, apparently, they can trace their lineage to a Selkie encounter, to one of these unions. They can trace their heritage to a Selkie marriage. And in some versions of the story, the Selkie never returns back in her human form, but sometimes the children will see a seal, you know, coming up to them and you know, playing with them every now and again. And it's pretty much heavily implied that that is their mother in a seal form, even if they never realise that themselves. So that's the typical female Selkie folktale. It's quite tragic, but it really does have an interesting message about captivity and not being, you know, not taming something which is wild, not trying to imprison someone or something that doesn't want to be with you or in a situation with you. You can find, you know, Selkies referenced in pop culture. There's a really lovely Irish film. Is it Onadine? Is that how you pronounce it? Anyway, I really like that film. It's really, really lovely. I haven't seen it in many years and I probably should go back and watch it. And of course, there's the beautiful animation Song of the Sea, a lovely film, another Irish film. I forgot to mention, actually, it is also, Selkies are also a part of Irish mythology as well. They seem to be predominantly in Scottish folktales, but they definitely exist in Irish mythology as well. I mean, there are pretty similar folktales that you can find in lots of places. There's also tales of the Finn folk, who are kind of similar to Selkies in that, you know, they'll take off... They're shapeshifters. That's what I was looking for. They're shapeshifters and they're sorcerers and all sorts of other things. They're a lot more gloomy. Well, I don't know. Selkies are kind of gloomy, aren't they, to be honest? But to be fair, they're justified in their gloominess, I find Selkies to be. Finn folk just seem to be all round gloomy anyway. That's the female Selkie. The typical structure of a Selkie folktale concerning a seal maiden. But what about the seal men? What about the male Selkies? They're usually quite different. A lot of the stories concerning male Selkies, one of which is captured in the Great Selkie of Sul Skerry, which is a Scottish folk song, and it has been covered by, you know, lots of different people, especially Joan Baez. How do you pronounce her name? Can someone tell me? Because I actually really do like her. Anyway, Joni, my friend Joan, she covered it in her song Selkie, which is one, I love it. It's a lovely, lovely song.
I am a man upon the land. I am a Selkie in the sea. And when I'm far and far frae land, my home it is in Sul Skerry.
I'm not sure if I can use the actual song, so for copyright reasons, have my terrible voice with lots of reverb instead. Well, you know, I take that back, actually. I've recently joined a shanty group and my voice isn't too bad, but it's better like singing very, very loudly in a pub rather than haunting, beautiful folk songs. I don't quite have the nuance for that, but there you go. It's a lovely song. But it tells the story of a male Selkie visiting a human woman. He says to her, like, look, love, I know I'm proper ugly and I'm a proper munter, but we're going to have a kid together, okay? So if I can just give you some money now, that would be great. And then I'll pick up my kid in approximately 3.4 years. And then, you know, we're going to swim around, have a great time for a little bit. And then tragedy is going to ensue. Is that all right by you? Is that okay? Brilliant. Great. Let's go ahead. Okay, not quite like that. It's a little bit more tragic and romantic than that. But essentially, a lot of male Selkie stories seem to be centered around a male Selkie visiting a human woman, maybe, I don't know what they get up to, and having a child by them. And in some of the stories, particularly in the Great Selkie of Sul Skerry, it ends up that they have a child together. The child goes with the Selkie and then she marries again and her husband is a gunner, and the very first shot that, no, shoot, I did not hit the right note for that. Ignore that whole bit. But anyway, he's a gunner, and the very first shoot that Aya he shoots very first shot that Aya he shoots ends up killing the Selkie and the son. So yes, tragedy abounds. So in the kind of the typical Selkie male myth, it seems to be that a Selkie man is a convenient excuse for being pregnant outside of marriage. Selkie men are sort of like randy buggers, actually. I imagine Selkie women as being very, like, beautiful and melancholy. And then the Selkie men are just like, hey, what's up? I can't do it. I'm sorry. I'm not going to try and do like some sort of Selkie Joey from Friends. It's, I don't have the voice for it, okay? And I'm very tired right now.
How you doing?
No, no. What was that? No, no, no. The children of these unions between Selkie and human were sometimes said to have webbed feet, webbed hands, and in some stories even had to like chip away at their webbed hands and feet, which sounds quite painful, to be honest with you, and not very inclusive, I have to admit. All bodies are beautiful, thank you very much. And no, that isn't sarcasm. All bodies are beautiful. So anyone out there listening to this who has webbed hands and webbed feet, don't feel bad about them. You're probably the human descendants of like an ancient mythological line of Selkie. So there you go, feel better about it. Not that you are probably feeling bad anyway. Oh, I don't know. I'm tired. Now, one thing I haven't mentioned is that 7 years seems to crop up in a lot of Selkie folktales. So this idea of 7 years. Now, 7 years is commonly found in a lot of folktales anyway. Very common. But in the terms of the Selkie folktales, it's often that if a Selkie sealskin is hidden, you know, it's 7 years a woman is bound to be someone's wife. And in terms of the male Selkie, it's 7 years that he will come back and visit his child, or he will only be able to visit his human wife every 7 years. And in some stories, the woman will cry 7 tears into the ocean. 7 tears sounds a little bit easier than 7 years. I wonder if there was some sort of like oral history mix up there. I'm gonna say if I had like a Selkie husband that I mostly got along with, just vibed with, but he needed his own space, I needed my own space, I think 7 tears would be much easier to reconnect than 7 years, to be honest with you. There really is an abundance of Selkie folktales, so it's why I haven't given you a specific one. There's lots of really similar stories, and as I said previously at the start of the episode, there's also a lot of Faroese stories of Selkies as well, which follow a lot of the same common tropes. In fact, there's the beautiful Selkie sculpture on Kelsoy, Faroese Island. All of these regions where Selkie folktales exist, it is seen as pretty bad luck to kill a seal. Only in the most dire, desperate circumstances is it seen as maybe okay to kill a seal. Otherwise, it is just seen as supremely, supremely bad luck. If you do so and you're a farmer, like a lot of your livestock are going to get killed. Just bad things are going to happen to you if you kill a seal. There have been some versions of stories that are a little bit more happy and less kind of abusive marriage. In some stories, the Selkie wife is happy in her marriage and even might realise that her husband does have her seal skin and just sort of turns a blind eye to it. But it does seem as soon as she comes across it, like physically holds her seal skin, there's something about her that is compelled to return back into the ocean. And in one story, one Faroese story actually, a Selkie gets married to a fisherman and against her wishes, he goes off into the sea and, you know, gets caught up in a storm and she changes back into her seal form and goes and saves him and then is stuck in her seal form and she can never go back to her human form in her happy marriage with him. But she chooses that and sort of sacrifices that happy version of her life to save him and go back and kind of use the powers she has as a Selkie maiden. So I thought I would end on a slightly more positive note there and not just doom and gloom and horrible stuff. Hopefully you enjoyed this podcast episode. I have to admit, I'm really tired. I've tried to record this episode a few times and it gets to a point where I have to just go for it. Otherwise, I will just not and then forget about it. And then, you know, I'll get busy and then months later, or I'll realise I never posted it and then that I'll just get discouraged and I just won't do it. So as I said in my previous episode, I'm just going to be a lot less, I'm not a perfectionist anyway, you can tell by these very silly, very probably unprofessional sounding podcast episodes, but I'm just going to go for it. I'm just going to, you know, do the podcast as best as I can in my kind of energy levels and time frame and what have you and just see where it goes. Thank you so much for your patience, all of you that have listened to my previous episodes, or if you are finding me for the first time from this episode and you have made it this far with all my chaos and strangeness, then thank you ever so much for listening to the episode. I hope that you enjoyed it. It is good. I know I complain about being tired, but it is a lot of fun for me to do the research and to share these stories with you. I really do wish I had more energy and time, because this is the exact type of thing that brings me joy and happiness in life, sharing folklore and researching it. This is what I want to be doing with more of my time, but there you go, wishful thinking. But if you do want to help me in that endeavour, then I do have a Patreon that you can support me on. I would very, very, very much appreciate it if you did. But, you know, these episodes are free. My whole podcast, it's free. I am never expecting people to pay for this. Thank you very much to anyone that does support me on Patreon. But it is never an expectation of mine. Thank you everyone for listening. Have a great night, and yes, speak to you soon.